नमस्ते। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई विश ऑल वेमेन आउट देयर, आई विश ऑल वेमेन अचीवर्स आउट देयर अ हैप्पी वेमेन्स डे ऑन द अकेशन ऑफ इंटरनेशनल वेमेन्स डे सेलिब्रेटेड ऑन 8th of March। यू नो, थॉट हैबिटेट स्पीक्स फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम हैज गॉन अ लिटिल अहेड एंड सेलिब्रेटेड द एंटायर वेमेन्स डे एज वेमेन्स वीक। The response from people has been so overwhelming that we are not going to celebrate it as an International Women's Week. Rather, it is going to be a whole lot of series. It is going to be an International Women's Year, in fact, for Thought Habitat, and it might even become a regular series. And that's what it is going to happen. From now on, we are going to carry forward this Accomplished Women series. And after this episode, you will see one episode of Accomplished Women every week. And I'm very happy to announce that. So, starting from 1st of March, we've covered women from footwear industry, and we covered a senior publicist on her 2-decade journey. And we spoke with a fintech entrepreneur, a fintech women entrepreneur who has coupled her passion for finance and retail with a fintech app. And then we spoke to a healthcare professional, a homeopathic practitioner and healer, followed by an academician who has been transforming the rural scene. You know, as we also said in that interview, empowerment is not only in the urban clusters. It is very much important for rural women and tribal women, basically. And Professor V. Rajeshwari, whom we interviewed, has been doing it through Mother Teresa Women's University as one of the initial working members. And she retired as the former dean. And then yesterday, we had our interview with Pooja Bajaj Chadda, who is taking forward her family legacy. And then she herself has a startup. Most interestingly, she has the perfect work-life balance. And our guest today is someone who is redefining the way we look at the world, I must say. Spreading love and kindness in this materialistic world is very difficult. You know, if someone says that we all are termed as fools according to the typical world norms. But Milen Sanga Gujral is redefining that. She is defying all those thoughts. She's a psychologist based out of Delhi, and she also has a passion for art. She's been in the world of mental health and creating awareness about mental health for the past 8 years. And we all have been badly hit by the COVID-19 lockdown and quarantine last year. And during that period, Milen has come up with something unique, which is called as the gratitude journal. And, you know, hundreds have been benefited out of it. You know, hundred still seems to be a small number, if I'm wrong. You know, several people have been benefited out of it. They could come out of the anxieties, and they really gave rave reviews about her journal. Okay, now I have spoken enough. So let us quickly welcome Milen Sanga Gujral, a professional psychologist and an art enthusiast from New Delhi. Milen, again, like as I've been telling throughout the series, that privilege having you here is a privilege is an understatement. and even welcoming you, thank you for joining us, is again an understatement. You know, I'm
thank
really getting
much.
Inspired with women like you out there. You know,
thank you so much,
Arvind. Inspiration is really not for women. Inspiration is for everyone. Inspiration is for women themselves. Inspiration is for men. And inspiration is for everyone out there. You know, hats off for all your efforts these years.
Thank you, Arvind. And I would say that I am honored to be here and that you're doing such a wonderful job of bringing up people who are working. You know, it's not just about any age group or anything. Like you just said, that somebody who's actually running their family business is also doing a startup. I mean, there's no right age to do what you feel passionate about. And change begins with you. So that's my motto in life, that, you know, if you want the world to change, then you change yourself. So that's the reason that I chose mental health in the first place. I wanted to pursue it and I wanted to understand about the human psyche, and it has really helped me understand a lot of issues that we all face. We are very, some of them are very difficult to talk about because there's still a lot of stigma that, you know, works around it. And I would say it's not just women, you know, a lot of women have become vocal about their mental health issues and their anxieties. But I think there are still men out there who are yet to step up and accept that even they go through similar kind of issues. I mean, there could be variable things that might be different, but it's mental health is something that does not differentiate between a man or a woman or any or race or gender or whatever. So it's so important to spread that awareness and to tell people that it's, you know, it's something that is also equally important to your physical health, and to end that stigma within the population and the society, and bring that awareness amongst people that, you know, it is such an important thing that it can actually start hampering your physical health and your day-to-day routine. It's so important to talk about and seek help when required.
It's really quite inspiring, Milind. So Milind, I'm jumping onto my question.
Sure.
I think love and kindness has been your motive, and you did explain your journey throughout now. And you eventually chose a career that would let you do it, right? So,
yes.
Would you like to define one trigger point or one incident that directed you to do this very strongly, to take it up very strongly at the first place?
Yes. I think every action is a sum of a lot of experiences that you have in your life. There's no one particular incident, but I think there's always a breaking point when you realize that enough is enough. So starting, you know, when you are growing up, when we are growing up, there are a lot of things that challenges that we face. I've always been like a plus size girl, and, you know, being good enough has come as a very difficult part of my journey because my acceptance depended on the way I looked. Then apart from that, I have seen people going through anxieties within my family, going through depression within my family, and not seeking help because they did not think it was something they would need to seek help for. And I think the breaking point was one of my cousins having lost her life over this battle.
I'm sorry about
yes. So yeah, that's okay. So basically what it is a sum of a lot of things where you keep on seeing things, but then there comes a breaking point when you realize, okay, maybe if I can understand and study about it, I can help a lot of people from going through the same fate. And that is what has pushed me into this field. And I am very happy that I did, because it helps you understand everybody and everything with a lot of compassion. You know, when you study psychology, you kind of, the first thing they teach you is to put yourself in the other person's shoes. And as easy as it sounds, when you are going through your own emotional vulnerabilities or upheavals, to put yourself in somebody else's shoes is very, very difficult. Because our emotions can be so overwhelming that they do not let us consider what the other person is feeling. And studying psychology makes you understand that we all have experiences or things in our life that shape our future or our character in a way, and that we are all struggling with our own battles. You know, a person might, sometimes you cross a person and, you know, they look very sad or they look very angry or they would, you know, say something very rudely. We are very quick to react. As human beings, we react very quickly to things that happen around us that we do not like. But we do not take in consideration that that person could have been having a bad day. He could have lost somebody he had loved or she had loved. They could be having a difficult time with certain things in their life. And taking into consideration all of that, it just makes you realize that there is so much need of compassion in this world because we are all struggling within ourselves. And I think there is a quote, I don't remember the exact quote, but it says that battles without are easier to fight than the battles within. I mean, you know, when you're fighting an external battle, it's a person you can see. It's something that makes a lot of sense. Exactly. While when you're fighting with your own feelings, sometimes we don't even you know exactly how we're feeling or what we're feeling, which is what has happened a lot in during the lockdown. You know, I feel that all of a sudden we were all shut inside and had to spend a lot of time with ourselves. And we don't do that usually. We are so externally built that we only focus on the external factors that are happening in our lives. And we sometimes use them as distractions at others, you know, it just avoids and we keep piling things in our own mind. And then when you have to be alone, it's very difficult because everything comes rushing back to you and that can get so overwhelming. So I think a lot of people I have, you know, a lot of clients I have had during the lockdown also had this issue where they were unable to understand where all these feelings and emotions were coming from.
Yeah, that's so, really great. You know, last year, I personally would say that, you know, I mean, locking up yourself in one room and not having anyone to talk, you know, you start thinking everything, like, why I don't have anyone to talk with me? Like, why is anyone not picking my call? Like, what happened? Like, did I do something wrong? And am I not looking good to do that? Am I not hilarious enough to talk? Like, you know, all these questions comes up and that really mattered a lot for us, you know, coming
and
out of
you know,
that.
This self-doubt is something that, you know, I do not blame the society or anything, but I would say that it has become like a normal thing in our society that we, a lot of people, I would say 90% of the people have grown up with a lot of self-doubt within us.
Yes, you know,
because every step of the way we've doubted ourselves. Will we be able to do this? Will we be able to do that? And you know, it all comes around to the theme of, am I good enough for this?
Yeah.
So, you know, when you doubt yourself, there are so many emotions, negative emotions that actually make you feel that, you know, you're not good enough in reality. And then what exactly is anxiety? It's anticipation. What is going to happen? When we're not sure in ourselves, what is going to happen becomes so unclear. And that causes a lot of anxiety.
Yes, I totally agree with that. Yeah.
Yes.
So, Milind, who do you consider as an inspiration in your life? If you had someone.
You know, a lot of people have ideals. I don't. I don't have one ideal person. I think every human being, every animal. I wouldn't just say human being. I have three dogs. and they teach me so much of compassion. Honestly, you can scold them, but end of the day, they will still come and snuggle up to you. The forgiveness, they teach me so much of forgiveness. So I think everything has a hidden inspiration in it. And anything can inspire you. Like sometimes, you know, you're randomly going in a car and you see somebody helping another cross the road and you are instantly inspired. You know, inspiration is everywhere. It's such a beautiful world. And I feel that I cannot idolize one person because every person will have good and will also have flaws. That's human. And that's good. And that's okay. And so I pick up whatever I feel, wherever I feel the good in, I just pick that up and let that inspire me. I think that's amazing. Like, especially nature. You can learn so much from nature. So it's everything for me.
That's pretty thoughtful, in fact. And yeah, so again, my third question is on each one of us went through emotional breakdowns, as I said before, you know, with lockdown and quarantine, you know, and we did not have anyone to talk for a long time. And that had a larger role to play in our lives. And, you know, many people eventually went to healers for online sessions. Because they couldn't travel and so they went for online sessions.
You know?
And I'm sure you would have had a lot of clients that day during that period, if I'm right.
I probably was one of the clients also. I mean, you know, if you're a like a lot of people think that if you're a psychologist, you do not go through emotions. That's not true. I'm a human first, right? So I might have learned a lot of coping strategies, but you know, sometimes in problems, even I am left thoughtless as to what to do. I am left, you know, very helpless at times. I get anxieties too. It's human. If you're human and you can feel, you're gonna have those kind of issues. Running away from them or not accepting them is not going to help us make those issues disappear. However, getting help, understanding them is very, very important. So, which is why when I went through a lot of difficulty because I might not be a very socially distinct person, like I don't do parties and stuff, but I like my occasional going out alone, getting a coffee by myself. I like the me time that I used to get. And you know, when you are closed within a house and you really want to go out and you can't, it feels like you are restricted. It's the mental thought behind it that, you know, I cannot go out because it's not allowed. And I don't want to go out because I don't want to are two different things. Yeah. So that mental restriction makes you feel closed. It makes you feel like you're in a cage, basically. And that leads to a lot of things, which is why I started certain activities myself. Like I researched a lot, I read through a lot, and I started certain things that really helped me get through the lockdown period. And that is also why I launched the Life Gratitude Journal, because I felt that it can help me, it could help like a lot more people. And honestly, it has. Like every time somebody tells me that it has helped them, it makes me really happy, because that means that I have like touched somebody's life in a positive manner. So I started a couple of things like affirmations in the morning, which are very positive and help you set a mindset for the day, because otherwise it was like, what day pata hi nahi chalta tha, you know, it was like Monday kya, Sunday kya, every day is the same. You're just inside. There's no concept. We used to sleep at like 4 in the morning, wake up whenever. So it disrupts the cycle of your life. And it also disrupts the way your body behaves, because the body also gets confused with a lot of things. So I started that. Then I started the gratitude practice, which basically is being thankful for what you have. You know, it's a competitive world. We are all running after things we want to achieve in our lives. And that's amazing as it is. But sometimes to take a step back and be thankful for what you have makes you feel good about where you are at in life. So basic things like, you know, food. So many people during the lockdown did not have access to proper food.
Yes.
That having food in your plate, having a proper shelter, having medical facilities and being able to, you know, get medical help or any kind of help. I mean, these things we overlook in our everyday lives. We kind of, you know, we take them for granted is the word. And it's not, I mean, them, I did too. So when I started the gratitude practice, for a couple of days, I felt ki kya likhun rose, kya likhun? Because what it asks you to do is write 3 different things every day. So you have to kind of tune into smaller things that make you happy. And, you know, like a cup of coffee, maybe in winter, a cup of tea. There's small things we do not even consider in our lives because we're so ready running after things we want than the things we have. So all these things help me see life in a better, more positive manner. And I wanted to be able to give that skill to other people as well so that they can also feel good about themselves and where they're at and within their lives.
Really great. You know, the gratitude practice and everything, it's pretty thoughtful, you know. That too, at a time when we all are struggling, you really empathized with the thoughts that many people have. And you came up with something, and that in itself is a big achievement, I would say. Yeah. And would you like to tell us more about the gratitude journal, like what sort of activities the journal has? And if someone has to get a journal regularly in their mailbox or in their phones or something, like how would they get that? Would you like to tell us about that?
Right. Firstly, I'll tell you about the journal. It's a life gratitude journal because it's not just gratitude. Just give me a second. It's not just gratitude activities. It's also therapy sheets that I've used. So the most important thing for us as humans is to understand our thoughts and know the emotions behind those thoughts and know ourselves. It's so important to know ourselves. We, you know, I'm married. So if somebody would ask me what is my partner's favorite color, I would know instantly. What do they like to eat? I'd know instantly. But when it comes to ourselves, we kind of give it a thought because we've not really thought about it as much. Yeah. You know, so going inward is such an important thing. It helps you self-discover yourself. So there are some self-discovery activities. There are reflections. So now, what exactly is reflections? Sometimes we go through the day, entire day, and at night, we're just like, there are so many mixed emotions. You know, you can have good experiences. You can have something like somebody dropped something on you or somebody said something that you felt was rude or you did not like the tone or something or the other. Now, how we go in life, we finish the day, we relax ourselves, watch TV, distraction, and we go to bed. This is a routine of a normal human being. What happens at that point of time, a lot of emotions and thoughts get mixed up in our minds. And that jumble can lead to a lot of overwhelm and anxiety within us because, you know, if you're not dealing with a particular thought, we don't really know what emotion it is carrying with it. So what that would do is it would make us feel very upset. Like there might something, say, for example, the same person said something tomorrow. you know, yesterday's information or incident, I did not really register it. I did not really reflect on it. I went the next day and the person said something again. And he might not even have said it in a wrong tone or manner, but I would perceive it as that because I'm carrying over the problem from yesterday in my head. So it's important to reflect. Reflection is understanding and dividing your thoughts and emotions and making sense of everything, letting it go and moving forward. Then there is forgiveness activities, like writing a forgiveness letter, for example, to somebody. And you know, a lot of people say that I find it difficult to forgive. It is difficult. I'm not saying it's an easy thing. Sometimes, you know, they have done so much wrong, or from their perspective, it might have been right. For us, it has been, we feel very hurt and upset about it. But forgiveness sets us free. If we forgive the person, we are free from, you know, being attached to them through an incident. So it's so important. So basically, the gratitude journal is not just gratitude activities. It's also a lot of therapeutic sheets, which are important in our life to move forward, to get to know ourselves, understand our goals, understand what we are looking or expecting from life, and then move forward with that. So that's what the gratitude journal is all about.
Yeah. So if at all someone wants to join that circle or forum, so how do we join?
So I have on Instagram, I have a page called @happystrokes.in. And I have a website, which I am refurbishing. Should be ready, but the other website is still working, so you can always order from there, or you can just send me, anybody can just send me a DM on my Instagram. Yes, and I am in fact in the future very soon launching some mental health stickers. I've already like made them myself. They're handmade, and I'm also be launching some t-shirts and stuff with mental health quotes, just to spread the awareness and the acceptance, and you know, to put that positivity back in the world. That's the aim and the vision.
That's really wonderful. So first of all, I must try it myself, and then I should spread it around to everyone. And I hope every single viewer, whoever is watching this, they would definitely do the same. And that's the gratitude we all give back to you for this session.
Thank you so much. My gratitude is when somebody can become happy, or you know, somebody can feel good about themselves, or you know, maybe start a chain of kindness and do something for somebody else, which is like really thoughtful. That is my gratitude. It just makes me very happy. I mean, compassion is something that is so needed in our world now.
That's really wonderful. And Milan, one last question. You know, many women out there are lacking motivation to move ahead. You know, I've personally seen a lot of them. They are highly skilled, you know, highly skilled in the sense they really have the ability to multitask and get everything done with 100% perfection. But you know, there is always one factor that is stopping them to move ahead, and that is themselves. You know, because they accept the societal stigmas, you know, and they don't want to move ahead. They accept the negative feedback from someone around them, and they don't want to move ahead. Okay, so people are judging me for this, so I'm not going to do this ahead. You know, what is that one advice that you would like to give them to come out of those stigmas?
There is no easy way to come out of it, because it takes work. I have gone through that phase myself, and but it's not impossible. It takes is self-belief, and that can come once you start going inward, you start believing in yourself. To say that people are always going to say something, we are built like that. We always, like, you know, sometimes subconsciously, unconsciously, we judge others. We do. And we get judged. But it's important to wake up every morning and remind yourself, every woman should remind themselves that they're not a princess, but a queen. Princesses look for prince to save them, but queens do not need a prince or a king. They can run the whole country by themselves. They can run the world by themselves. So it's so important to change that mindset, wake up and feel that, you know, it's you are capable. I think a lot of it, affirmations have really helped me. But I'll tell you, the hack that has really helped me and a lot of my clients is standing in front of the mirror and telling myself to do it. There have been times where, you know, I would feel really demotivated or would feel that, you know, I don't have the energy to do it. Or, you know, women, actually, why all this happens is women take a lot of emotional baggage with them. They carry everybody's emotional baggage with them because we have the capacity to. We are built like that, that we have the capacity to. So they let that baggage weigh them down. If they let that baggage go, what happens, happens, and move forward, it's easier. So standing in front of the mirror and telling yourself you can do it is like somebody telling you that you can do it. That's the psychological, how the mind works. The mind will presume that there is somebody standing in front of you telling you you can do it. And sometimes that's more than enough.
That's really wonderful. You know, as you rightly said, if women have the capacity to carry forward excess emotional baggage with them, they definitely have the capacity to move ahead and do anything that they want. Right? And that suits not only to women, but to anyone.
That suits, I think, to men, even men. Well. Like, a lot of people, I feel personally that there's a lot of women empowerment happening now. But there should also be the fact that men also need all these things. It's so important because, you know, we as humans, we are built maybe slightly separately, but majorly the same. We have the same brains. We have the same minds. So we need to not just talk about women empowerment, but also empowering each and every human being, regardless of their gender, race, or whatever. We should empower each and everyone, men included. I mean, you know, we say that women are doing a lot. Men have a lot of responsibilities too. It's not that they're not living up to them. They are. And I think that needs to be acknowledged as well. So I feel that men should be applauded. I mean, if I was to look after my entire family, I would still think twice about the responsibilities I would hold on my head. Every man has to do it pretty much in our society. You know, so to acknowledge those things are also equally important. And I think we should, each and every human should work on empowering each and every person whose lives they touch, regardless of them being a woman or a man or whatever.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's very thoughtful of you to say that. And Milan, it was a wonderful session with you. You know, throughout the series, I'm sure that we've been getting a lot of viewers, not only the existing ones, we've been getting a whole lot of viewers to watch this, you know. And your session today has been a great value addition to everything. So
you
not
so
only empowered women here, you empowered men, and you empowered anyone who needs emotional support to move ahead, who need empathy to move ahead in their life. And I am sure they have the gratitude of you being here today, and you have my gratitude for being here today.
And I am very grateful for you having called me. I really, I mean, I was very honored to be a part of this. So thank you so much.
Yeah. So we are looking forward for more sessions with you, Milan.
Absolutely. I would love that.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Have a